absence for the order meeting that we received from councillors Alison Craw, Nick Crofts, Anthony Lavelle, James Roberts, Carol Sun, Hetty Wood, Gerard Woodhouse, Lisa Gorman, Pauline Walton. Could I look at apologies? In terms of declarations of interest on items on tonight's agenda, can I just remind members that you're only required to declare at meetings any disclosable pecuniary or prejudicial interest, in which case the member will need to leave the chamber during consideration of that item. Are there any such declarations from members?
Minutes of the last meeting. Is the agreed?
Agreed.
Agreed. Right, part one. Public question time. Now, if you've got your phones out, turn them off and put them away. Because we've got people who are going to be making statements here tonight. And we've got councillors who will be doing first speeches, right? So let's start showing respect to the people in this chamber and to the residents of this city, because you're here for the residents of this city. And if anybody wants to know what's going on, the Echo has a live line. You can look through the Echo here. Yes, no, will be. Okay. So turn your phones off and let's start showing respect, right? Okay. Right, I'd like to first statement is by Lord Andrew Adamus in relation to item 11 on the agenda, the Mayor's motion, the people's vote for your
I don't know. Thank you very much for that kind of introduction. 10 years ago, as a European city of culture, Liverpool symbolised the renaissance, not only of the great city, but of the European ideal of common culture, common humanity, and the rebirth of hope. Mayor Jo Anderson played a key part in securing this tribute to this great city, and in the years since, he and this City Council have taken the city forward with vision and skill. You have mobilised to the full all that Europe has to offer: peace, trade, skill, the free movement of people across our continent, and the resources of the European Union for regional growth and development. Today's great industries of Liverpool, including the car industry, the ports, your prestigious universities, and your burgeoning film industry, are European, and enlightened funding and support from the European Union have transformed the physical environment of the city, from the redevelopment of Queen Square to the new cruise liner terminal, which revives the glory of Liverpool at its imperial zenith. So the motion which you're considering today, Lord Mayor, is entirely fitting, and it is entirely characteristic that Mayor Anderson and the City Council should be leading with such principle and conviction. I believe the stand being taken by Liverpool today will be a clarion call to the nation at large, that we are European, that we value our European culture for peace and prosperity, that we will not surrender Europe for an isolationist and job-destroying Brexit, which was never put to the British people, and that we want a people's vote, and that in that people's vote, we will campaign for the best interests of the people of this city and this country to stay at the heart of Europe and the European Union. Lord Mayor, it is a huge privilege for me to be supporting this motion in this historic town hall. David Morrissey says of the city, "Liverpool has always made me brave, choice-wise. Today, Liverpool is making the country brave, choice-wise. doing so in the most noble and most urgent cause, Britain's place in Europe. Lord Mayor, history will never forget. Thank you very much.
Well, we're just briefly, because we have got a motion to debate. I thank Andrew Rotherdonis for coming here. He's absolutely right that Liverpool has always led the way in championing this city, but also peoples across Europe. I would simply say to him that we are a proud European city. We're, as you rightly pointed out, the other thing is a capital of culture. We are a city that voted strongly to remain in Europe. And our memories don't have to go back too long, but only to the 80s, when central government, our own government, our own UK government, actually had a policy of managed decline, where our city was to suffer greatly as a result of that policy. And it was Europe that kick-started and helped this city fight back and to regenerate itself to the state that we see today. Our motion, can I be absolutely clear, is a call for central government to give this council and the people of this country a say in a final decision, a people's vote, whether that's through another referendum based on facts, hard facts, that we can see in front of us, or whether it's through a general election. It is not a personal call on any one particular individual or leader of any party. It is, as you rightly say, a rallying call to the whole country to unite, to give one democratic loud voice, to vote on something that they can see the facts of, not scaremongering or innuendo or smears, but hard facts, plain and simple. And as I say in my motion, if you buy a house, you subject that to a condition survey. If you cancel your car insurance, it normally asks you three times whether you want to cancel it. And that's all we are simply saying. When the deal is done, or not done, as it seems the case may well be, that the people of this city have a voice. I thank you for championing that in your capacity, and I will certainly continue to campaign and champion it in my capacity. Thank you, Andrew.
Second statement by Tanya Sweeney from Unite the Union in relation to item 15 on the agenda. Fair Hospitality Champion campaign.
Thank you for inviting us to address this meeting tonight. We hope you all support our Fair Hospitality campaign. Trade union membership is very low in the hospitality industry. This is why pay is low and why the work is hard, often unsafe and regularly insecure. Often the only way to change things and to have a voice at work is to join a union. However, it is recognised that there are barriers that prevent staff from doing this, such as a lack of knowledge of unions, a fear that they aren't allowed to join and that a union isn't relevant to them, or that joining won't make a difference. While we all realise that this isn't the case, and by joining a union we will get representation both on an individual and collective basis, the balance of power has shifted so dramatically that our campaign is not just about encouraging trade union membership, but promoting the adoption of minimum standards, which you'll find in our hospitality charter at the back of the room. This campaign would seek to benefit all employees within the sector, as we want to make sure there is no one hotel, restaurant or bar undercutting those who want to ensure that staff are afforded basic protections on salary, trade union access and adequate respect, to name just a few issues that our young members commonly raise. We campaign to make sure tips go to workers, not employers, and for a fair distribution of the service charge. We want all workers to be treated with dignity and respect by employers and customers alike. Too often, flexible work means flexibility for the employer and uncertainty and stress for the worker. The use of 4-0 and short hour contracts needs to stop. We want meaningful training and we want staff to be able to develop at work. Why is it that this work is often undervalued and not seen as a decent job? Access to trade unions should not be frowned on. You can read the leaflets, pop-ups, and see our charter at the back of the room, that you will hopefully sign after this motion is passed. We're not asking for any unrealistic demands. Surely you would all want these for ourselves, our family, and our friends. Joining our campaign will help workers in this industry to improve their terms and conditions. Our membership is growing all the time. We have already had fantastic victories in recent campaigns, such as our Fair Tips campaign. I'm sure you all have seen young members across the region from TGI Fridays stand up, stick together and fight against the changes that will disproportionately affect their income. There's an appetite for change, and Unite are pleased that this motion has been tabled. We would encourage all members to publicly show their support, and equally importantly, encourage employers within the city to adopt the ask of the Fair Hospitality campaign. Thank you.
I wouldn't, obviously we've got a debate again, so I'll just be brief, but want to say a couple of things. Tanya, if you can pass our best wishes to Conrad and Fraternal, best wishes to the TGI workers and to the dispute. But it's ironic, isn't it, that we just talked about the 80s and a Tony government inflicting man's decline. And of course we see the consequences of a government now that continues that same assault on trade unions and on workers. And you know, we only have to go back 60 years here in Liverpool when T&G, as it was then, the Transport and General Workers Union, actually fought against what was then similar to 0 hours, and that were men banged up in pens, begging for work every single day. And that campaign to end that across the country was led by the Transport and General Workers in this city. And we're proud that Unite leads the way in campaigns for workers' rights across the country. And let me say this, as a city that was built on our cultural offer to the world in terms of, especially in recent times, the European capital culture and our tourism and investments, that we view the hospitality sector as not only a proud sector but a valuable sector to the growth of our city. And I would give this message loud and clear to workers working in the hospitality sector: join a trade union, be part of a movement that is demanding change and will get change. And where we operate as a city, we need to send a clear message to our partners that we won't tolerate working with you if you treat your workers as second-class citizens. And that's what we can do in terms of showing our solidarity. And I think you'll find that the motion, as it's debated and voted on tonight, will be accepted unanimously by this council.
Made statement by Elaine Boker, Principal of the City of Liverpool College, in relation to item 22 on the agenda, protecting the allocation of skills funding.
Thank you for allowing me to speak to motion 22, presented to Council by Deputy Mayor Councillor Gary Miller and his colleagues, about the need to protect future allocation of skills funding for Liverpool and the wider city region. I'm speaking here today as the Principal and Chief Executive of the College, the City of Liverpool College. Over the last decade, good progress has been made on the skills and employability front, even though we have more to do. Thousands of local residents have been helped to improve their skills, become more employable, and give local businesses the talent that's needed for economic growth and competitiveness. Despite this success, significant challenges remain. Liverpool and wider cities and regions still have a high proportion of adults that remain economically inactive and a disproportionate number of adults with no qualifications. 8% above the national rate in Liverpool and 4.4% above the national rate for the wider Liverpool City region. Over 7,000 adults came to my college last year and achieved valuable qualifications and for helping them now to gain jobs. And again, another 7,000 students will gain qualifications, largely adults, this year, helping to transform our communities, providing the talent pool for the business, and helping Liverpool become more competitive. In the very near future, we face two significant changes. The loss of our European Social Fund, known as ESF, and a reduced adult education budget, known as AEB, which have the potential to undermine our abilities to continue to train and develop our local residents in the volumes that's required to tackle serious skill shortages and deliver the economic success of our city. Both of these changes pose a very serious risk to the city and its residents and its employers. Should these funds be renewed or reduced, it will have very serious consequences. We've seen the European Social Fund displace demand from the adult education budget over recent years, largely because that funding is more flexible in supporting those adults who have been economically inactive for a period of years. Any replacement funding or transitional funding will be short-term and therefore only provide a short-term solution. The adult education budget comes from our domestic budgets and is therefore a longer-term revenue stream for Liverpool and must be protected. But the allocation for the city region is set on the basis of how much funding has been spent in 17-18 and 18-19. Demand is clearly being artificially deflated by the use of the finite European Social Fund money. We as a college have already received notification from the Education Skills Funding Agency that our £9.5 million allocation will likely be reduced in 18-19 in preparation for devolution of the budget to the Liverpool City region. The guidance states that colleges who spend less than 97% of the allocation in 16-17 and or 17-18 will be rebased in year, following the year-end claims. This now is unequivocal evidence of the future threat to these funds to our city. It would be much easier for civil servants to argue that we have not, as a city region, spent all of our adult education funding and refuse the request regarding transitional protection around our European Social Fund. At the same time, we face a potential reduction in the adult education budget. The City of Liverpool College fully supports this motion, because the impact on our residents is very real at a time when we need skills more than ever. And therefore, we should be arguing to safeguard our budget. And we fully support the motion submitted by Deputy Mayor Councillor Gary Miller and his colleagues. And we ask the government to ensure the funds devolved to the Liverpool City region are sufficient in view of the reduced European Social Fund and protected for all the reasons outlined. Thank you.
Well, but this is another example of central government playing ducks and drakes, smokes and mirrors, whatever way we want to describe it. In reducing our allocation of funding, 2 years ago, we gave a red line to central government about the devolution to the city region. And that was that they would devolve to us full funding, including the European funding allocation. In other words, the funding that we would receive to the devolution skills agreement would match what we would lose to ESF. That was a commitment that was given by central governments and why we accepted the city region devolution deal. Metro Mersey, Rotherham and the leaders have been campaigning really hard to try to get them to not just match that promise, but to accept the fact that if we use the formula of ESF funding, then we will seriously lose out on funding. And I think, although Elaine didn't go into the financial details, it's probably somewhere around a third of her budget that will be lost. And that will have a detrimental impact on the skills and the development of skills within Liverpool, and of course beyond Liverpool, with the other colleges also being affected across the city region. So we will continue to argue for that. We will continue to lobby for that. And I would continue to urge other cities that are facing similar problems to unite together in core cities and through organisations like the LTA to seriously challenge government in terms of to make sure that proportionately in terms of the poverty and the amount that we used to receive from ESF funding, that is retained. And that's the real challenge for us, to get them to understand and not rename on the promises.
Item 4. Urging key executive decisions taken in the last cycle. Is there any questions? No? Have you agreed? Okay. Item 5. Mayor Anderson to present any updates. Good.
A number of comments from me and updates. Of course, we've got the next item, which is the appointments of the new chief executive, if it's supported agreed by the council, so I will not make any comments on that. Just a few things in relation to what is neighbourhood governance. There will be a paper presented to the next council meeting in September with regard to developing the council's neighbourhood governance arrangements. And basically, this is to, in line with the growth, inclusive growth plan, which is to facilitate a conversation with residents as outlined within that particular plan. So the neighbourhood governance will look at how we engage and how we do that, and also how we support local board members looking at the allocation of funding that boards get, and how we improve and target that funding moving forward. So it's an important conversation, and it's an important message that we need to communicate, that if we are serious about inclusive growth, then we've got to target our limited resources in a better and more efficient way. So we'll be looking at a framework that's flexible but delivers for the communities that we serve, and our councillors are really engaged in that process. And it's sort of following on from this, we see how we need to address, if you like, some of the inequalities that exist in different parts of the city. You know, why we can't, for instance, class certain more affluent parts of the city in the same way we should other parts of the city. And there was a big concern about certain parts of the city, in particular North Liverpool or Kensington, Tubridge, where we've got, in particular in the terraced housing in those particular areas, the rat infestation and problems there. So we're looking at, or I'm going to be looking at, putting a fund of around about 1.2 to 1.5 million of Section 106 funding in to support those particular areas, along with United Utilities, who we've had a conversation with and want to work with us to look at bending the sewerage systems around those alleys in those particular areas, so that we can actually try to fix the alleyways and tackle that particular area. But that's an example of how we need to review some of the 106 spend. There's been a report that was submitted to Cabinet that looks at how that 106 funding can be spent. I intend to take that to the new arrangements that are going to set up that neighbourhood governance arrangements for people to have a look at how we spend and the way we spend Section 106, but also other monies available to those particular areas. And that will, as I said, be presented to the next council meeting. We're also setting up some seminars and some opportunities for councillors to engage in that debate about how we move forward with that that review. We also, I mentioned at the last meeting that we would reflect and review elected members' allowances. So I think Chris Walsh will be sending, as head of committee services, will be sending a note to all elected members concerning the timeline for that exercise and a questionnaire around the submission to the panel and how that's going to be facilitated and how that's been getting done. I also mentioned about a member development and effective working group. Councillor Natalie Nichols will agree a process and a way forward, agree a member development programme for 2018-19. There will also be devised a member and officer development programme for the coming year. Develop effective neighbourhood working, and this is about what I've just been talking about supporting members of the community in leadership roles. It will be about supporting people, enabling people to do that. It will also undertake a review the current member officer protocol and the ward communication protocol as it will be picked up as part of that whole system review. So, opposition members, can I advise you to give your named representatives to Chris Walsh? Thank you, Councillor Ralph, for indicating that you already have. As you are aware, the IT equipment for elected members has started to be rolled out. I think there's 50 members already received the new tablets, and if any members haven't yet received those, then you need to contact Mike Jones, who will set up that particular route to get access to your new equipment. Just a couple of things on some other items. Football Hubs investment has now been rolled out very rapidly. There's a couple of issues that have arisen with this. There are we'll make a 20 million investment, around about 7 million of that is ours, that are around for Zachary Walton Allison. They'll be ready for use in September, but there's been a bit of delay. The Jericho playing fields, for instance, will be ready till October. That's to do, believe it or not, with the tides and how the tides rise, believe it or not, it floods part of the Jericho fields, and that's delaying us with all the rain. There'll be some delay. There'll be added costs to that. It's Alfringay. An report to Cabinet for people to have a look at that. It was a great initiative, it's a great opportunity for us. And now with those facilities, as I said, around £20 million, it's going to be, I think, well, it already is universally accepted by the leagues and by the County FA as a real step change in providing facilities. And of course, I think it's also worthwhile when we talk about that particular allocation of funding, 20 million, which, as I said, is going to be fantastic, because it means that in the winter months when games are called off at the drop of a hat, these games, because their own new pitches, will be able to continue. But I just want to remind you as well, because we've also, as well as that investment of 20 million, we've also invested 10 million. Over the last 3 years, including Waverley, £350,000 in a new PG pitch, Broadview School, which is open to the public as well, £245,000 on a new PG pitch. St John Bosco, again, open to the community, £1 million for a new PG pitch and ancillary facilities. Croxford, Carway East, £1.2 2.2 million for a new heating pitch and ancillary facility. One more park, 250 for a new heating pitch with the County FA. Jeffrey Hall playing fields, £850,000 for the changing pavilion. Bill Shankly playing fields, £800,000 for the changing pavilions. Evan in the community working with them at the community hall, £820,000 for new community facilities. And Archbishop Beck, £350,000 for adaptations to the short sports hall to accommodate disabled people. So it clearly shows that the investment got trusted park life in the 20 million, but another 10 million has been invested. And that, of course, is the mention of all the skate parks and our skateboard facilities that we've put in parks across the whole city. So that is a good news. The other thing, just to give you an update, maybe mention about the Poly Fields site, which is a piece of land that we acquired next to the Simpsons playing fields, and if you look down towards the river next to Clark Gardens, it's our intention. Regen are working on this, but then we need to engage with the councillors in those particular wards that neighbour the Pony Fields. It's actually on the opposite side to Allen and Towers. Disgracefully, I see the leaflets on Monday, it's the Lib Dems and Talent people in that particular area that were selling Allen and Towers for housing. What we're actually doing, and it will be discussed with the community and with the ward councillors, the 12 new acres of land that we've acquired and purchased, we're actually setting up a nature trail. And that nature trail is going to connect Allerton Towers on the eastern side of the Pony Fields. It's going to connect with Clark Gardens on the southern side of the site. And it's also, we're looking at seeing if we can do a permanent bridge structure to link Camp Hill with Walton Woods and also the land that was acquired from the Archdiocese. So in line with some of the things that Simon O'Brien was talking to me about connecting our green spaces, it will have a cycle path that connects all those green spaces, and it will also be a nature trail for some of the inner city kids to go to that particular area. So it's something that we look forward to, and despite, as I said, it's ironic, isn't it, that they took put out a leaflet about us building on that site. We're going to be putting out leaflets to tell people how we're supporting and developing that for the interests of the community. Just also on that particular issue of the environment, we've just agreed a memorandum of understanding with a company called Poseidon, and our aim is within a number of years, they're looking at locating the staff who've sent signed this memorandum of understanding. And basically, what it means is that we will become the first carbon positive, climate positive city by 2020. Now, how it works is using blockchain technology to measure your carbon outputs and then to offset that. So I've already had some conversations with some companies that actually want to buy in to that. They're going to bring Poseidon, they're going to bring their research and development company to the city, and it means that we can actually develop and become the first city in the whole world, actually, not just in the UK or abroad in Europe, to become that first climate positive city by the end of 2020. An exciting opportunity that we're going to be engaging with businesses in September, and we've also looked to do a seminar with all councils to actually discuss how we make progress and what it actually means. But it really is an exciting opportunity for us, working with people that are committed quite strongly to the environment, but also using blockchain technology, which is an advanced form of monitoring how our emissions weigh and what it is as Liverpool, as a city, we do emit in terms of carbon dioxide. We've got a motion on highways maintenance, but I'm just delighted to say that we will have an interactive map that shows the investment that's going to be taking place in the city where that investment is going to be, exactly how much that is going to be, and when the roads will be paid. And we'll be having a discussion within the motion, but I know there's particular controversy with the Greens, and I don't know if we're talking about road safety and how road safety is important to them, are arguing that we don't fund the road repair programme. The reality is that we will fund this over a 5-year period, and at any one time, if it is going to impact, which it won't, but if it was going to impact on our revenue payments, we just stop it. Stop it. Because it's not £200 million loan, £40 million in the first year and then beyond. So at any time, we can just stop it. But the reality is, I just point this fact out, it was in 2002 in this city. Have people got any idea what we paid out in claims, just in triple claims in our city in 2002? Was under the then leader of the council, who's now a Lord storyteller of Alton, or whatever. How much we actually paid out? How much we actually paid out? Any ideas? Any guesses? £12 million. £12 million in triple claims. Fact on record. But the reality is, if we don't do something and address the condition of our roads, not only is the potential claims going to rise, and they're at a very, very high rate now, somebody, cyclists, motorists, people are going to get seriously hurt, and the problem is going to cost us more. It's going to actually cost us more. And so the good sign of a prudent, financially responsible city is to be able to invest and do things that stop us facing those financial challenges in the future. And so the motion I look forward to having a debate around that. Just to let you know, I addressed around about 1,500 members of our staff last week at the arena, the convention centre. I passed on to them the messages that we received from the LGA and from Ofsted. We had a report from Ofsted that was not great, but given the financial circumstances that we're in, the positive message that we got from them and the letter that we got from them tell us that they were comfortable and satisfied with the progress that we were making and the financial commitments that we were putting into that particular service, that they were fine. The LGA pointed out really strongly that our staff in this city were our biggest assets. Something that we already know, because we're proud of our staff in this city. But it was great to report to them how proud not only we are, but that their efforts and their hard work was recognised by the LGA. And of course, we also had the LGA Finance Review, which pointed out that we were the second lowest core city in terms of borrowing in the country. And of course, that I'll mention in the debate that we have on the roads, that our cap, where our level of borrowing can be, we are hundreds of millions of pounds lower than where that cap can be. So we can borrow more if we wanted in terms of for infrastructure or capital investment, but we don't. So we're prudent, and that is also recognised by the LGA in terms of their peer review in finance. The LGA itself was, I think, we'll await the official report, but they were hugely impressed not only with our staff, but went out of their way to praise the dementia hubs in Sedgemoor and Lyme and Granby. It's great to see Councillor Lyme sitting there, because she led the way in developing those particular hubs, and the praise we received and the innovation that they talked about leading the way is something we should be amazingly proud of, and this council. Also, Lord Mayor, just a couple of quick things around see that happening. The cruise liner terminal waiting to start on the cruise liner itself. You see the trains and stuff out there actually where we start on the site itself in October, but all the preparation work is starting now. We're looking forward to that. We still hold Cunard to the commitment once it's done to establish the Liverpool to New York again. Which is amazing. The car park, the ACC, the car park, I can tell you that it's been hugely difficult to try and cut through all of this, but we've managed now to settle with our insurance companies with regards to the payments that should be getting made to us. So October, because of the conference and whatever, we're not going to start work till October, but work will start. But we've been talking to about 100 different insurance companies. It's been really, really difficult and very, particularly tribute to the Cabana and the team and all of the financing team and everybody that's trying to resolve that. But at least work starts in October. Because I know I kept telling people and stuff that we'll settle the panel on Everton's financial arrangements if we agree them. At the moment, there's nothing to report because although our, if you like, side of it is going through due diligence, it's almost complete and finished. The fact is that Everton haven't come back to us yet, and they're in continuing dialogue with other people. So what happens with regards to that particular arrangement remains to be seen. But of course, when I get some information on that, I will then set up the panel for scrutiny so everybody can see, as I said repeatedly, that they will see openly and transparently any arrangements that we will be looking at in the near future. And that's all from me.
Two people have indicated, do you want to speak, Councillor Kenneth?
Yes.
So first, Councillor Radford, then Councillor Crowe, did you want to speak? And then you, Councillor Kenneth.
Thank you, my Lord Mayor. Thank you, Mayor Anderson. I'm really hard pleased about the commitment to look at the highways. And as utilities, I have to say, we've been writing to highways for quite a while, asking for some costings without reply, maybe no way for the bigger allocation. I'm really pleased about that. On the Labour government, we've already put my floor my name to support that committee. Just two little suggestions, because obviously we've got to debate it now. One of the things that we used to have when we had the area committee that worked well, and I think there's been a bit of a disengagement since, was when we had health subcommittees for each area, there was much more information about a local area about what the health practices were doing and what the health providers were. And I think those of us looking for long-term solutions and how to improve the condition of health, which is a big inequality in the city, that may be something the neighbour governments could look at. One of the things I debated with Councillor Mombi, I think was a regressive step. Once we used to have a ward committee that looked after youth and sports activities, and we actually had that with the youth providers and ward councils all in the same room together, you actually got a bit more synergy between the different groups, rather than sort of the youth providers making recommendations, making a little paper exercise for things. I think that's something we could maybe look at returning. I think that was far more effective. The other contribution I'd like to make as an open offer is, as a community in Tuberville, we've really benefited by establishing a community charity, the Tuberville Club Group. I know I've worked with